Okay, good afternoon, everyone. So my name is Jimit Shah. I'm a PhD student in the lab of Professor Sandra City in Department of Cell Biology at University of Geneva. So our lab mainly works on epithelial cell-cell junctions. What makes epithelial cells special is the presence of the apical junctional complex that includes tight junctions and adherence junctions. And as you know, that cell junctions, they are multi-molecular complexes that consist of transmembrane proteins, proteins that are found just under the cytoplasm, which we call as cytoplasmic plaque proteins, which are connected to the cell cytoskeleton. So some of the proteins, or in fact most of the proteins of the adherence junctions, they're also found laterally, and which we call them as lateral cell contacts. Okay. The role of these cell-cell junctions is to protect the cells, to connect the cells to each other, and to protect the cells and to maintain a permeability barrier between the outside and the inside. Now, over the period of time, the bacteria have evolved to use these transmembrane proteins of the cell junctions as their receptor to gain, to attach, first of all, to the cells and to get the entry in the cells in, so that it can infect and basically kill the cells. But nothing really is known about the role of the proteins that are present at the cytoplasmic plaque and how they can control the host-pathogen interactions. So this is an example, the Staphylococcus aureus bacteria, and in fact its antibiotic resistant strain that we call as MRSA, it's a growing threat to human health worldwide, and it's responsible for many different kinds of respiratory and skin infections. The reason they are so effective against us is because they produce a variety of virulence factors. And one of the virulence factors is alpha-toxin, which is secreted by the bacteria as water-soluble monomers. These monomers, they can bind to ADAM10, which is the receptor. It's already known that it is the receptor for alpha-toxin. It oligomerizes to form a first a pre-pore complex, and then it forms a fully functional pore, causing imbalance of ions in the cells and eventually leading to cell death by apoptosis or necroptosis. So now our collaborators in Stanford, they performed a screen using CRISPR library and HAP cells, and they wanted to know that what, apart from ADAM10, are the host factors required for alpha-toxin cytotoxicity. And most important thing for us, that they identify several of the proteins of the cell-cell junctions and the cytoplasmic plaque proteins. And one of them was PLEKHA7. So they did a lot of experiments to validate the screen, but the most important experiment they did was to look at the intracellular ATP levels upon the treatment of either the wild-type cells, the PLEKHA7 knockout cells, or ADAM10 knockout cells with the alpha-toxin. And as you can see here, that the initial drop of intracellular ATP between the wild-type cells and PLEKHA7 knockout cells is similar. But somewhere at around 3 or 4 hours, the PLEKHA7 knockout cells, they are recovering. Now it holds a lot of significance because this says that there is no defect in the pore formation or no change in the kinetics of the pore formation. So how is that PLEKHA7 able to regulate the susceptibility of the cells to toxin? And here there is a control, which is ADAM10 knockout, and here you can see that there is no change in the ATP levels, as it is already known that in the absence of ADAM10, there is no pore formation. They were able to also duplicate the results in vivo, where you can see that they treat the ears of the wild-type mice with live bacteria, and over the period of 14 days, you see a lot of tissue damage. Well, in the PLEKHA7 knockout mice, there was tissue damage, but it was much less than the wild-type, and after a few weeks, they survived and it was all okay. So my question, or what I want to understand, is how PLEKHA7 is able to regulate the susceptibility of the cells to this toxin. So what is PLEKHA7? So PLEKHA7, as I mentioned before, it's a protein that is present at the cytoplasmic plaque of adherence junctions. As you can see that it has several domains and it has several interactors, but for this work, it's important to remember that the N-terminal WW domain of PLEKHA7 could interact with PDZD11. We identified a few years back. And the pH domain was identified to interact with aphaidin. And it also involves in many cellular and pathophysiological processes. So now to understand the role of PLEKHA7 in controlling the susceptibility of the cells to toxin, we asked four questions. First question was, what is the localization of ADAM10 in epithelial cells? and how the absence of PLEKHA7 could affect the localization. So what we find here is that ADAM10 was co-localized with PLEKHA7, which is the marker of junctions, and as well as ZO1. But PLEKHA7 was also found on the lateral surfaces. So this is important that you remember that there are two populations of ADAM10, one at the junctions and one on the lateral surfaces. So now, when you remove PLEKHA7, so this is the scheme for the B result. So when you remove PLEKHA7, what you see is only the zonular accumulation of ADAM10 is absent in the knockout cells. But the lateral distribution of PLEKHA7 of the ADAM10 in PLEKHA7 knockout cells is not affected at all. We also did some rescue experiments, and we identified that the WW domain of PLEKHA7 was partially able to rescue the junctional clustering of ADAM10. And as I mentioned before, that WW domain, it interacts with the protein PDZD11 and also helps its recruitment at the junctions. We wondered that PDZD11 might also be involved. And in fact, PDZD11 was also identified in the screen. So what you see here is that when you put when you treat the wild type cells or the knockout for PLEKHA7 and PDZD11 with alpha-toxin and look at the cell death by propionium iodide staining and FACS, you see that both PLEKHA7 and PDZD11 knockout cells, they are more or less behave similar, and they are more resistant compared to the wild type cells to alpha-toxin. Again, we tried to look at the intracellular ATP levels, and PDZD11 knockout, they behave similar to PLEKHA7 when they are treated with alpha-toxin. And also, we I don't show here, but they phenocopy also the localization of ADAM10, similar to that of PLEKHA7. So now we ask other question. So here I don't explain a lot of basic introduction things, but what is already known from the literature is that tetraspanins, there are around 33 of tetraspanin proteins, of which there are 6 proteins which are classified as tetraspanin C8 subfamily, and all of them are known to interact with ADAM10, promote its maturation and surface delivery. So we thought that the question was that what brings ADAM10 to cell-cell junctions. So we did a lot of screening and we identified that tetraspanin 33 is actually localized exactly at apical zonular junctions, at ahaerens junctions, co-localizing with PLEKHA7. And this localization of tetraspanins is also dependent on PLEKHA7 as well as PDZD11. So if you remove PLEKHA7 or PDZD11, they are more cytoplasmic, and I don't show here the XZ staining, but it's more lateral and not zonular, as you can see for the wild type conditions. So next, we ask the third question, which is what happens to the toxin pores when you treat the cells with alpha toxin. So similar to ADAM10 tetraspanning, it's again the repetitive things, but what we find is that also alpha toxin pores, they are clustered at the zonular junctions, ZO1 being the marker, and they are distributed on the lateral surfaces of the cells. But in the absence of PLEKHA7 or PDZD11, the lateral distribution of pores is still present, but only the zonular accumulation of the pores is absent. So this this becomes more clear that why in PLEKHA7 knockout cells you still see effect of toxin, but it's it is able to recover. So next we move to HAP cells with the use in the screen, and they are very easy to use. They require very less toxin. So we prefer to use this instead of epithelial cells, and they form small cell-cell contact sites instead of zonular junctions. So we treated these HAP cells with toxin, and then we wanted to know how stable is the toxin pores that is present at cell-cell contacts. So we treat them for either 5 minutes and 30 minutes. So you can see that at 30 minutes, there is significant amount of pore formation in the wild-type cells. But now what we do is we remove the toxin from the media. So we let the cells recover for either 2 hours or 4 hours. And then what we found that the amount of toxin which was clustered at the cell-cell contact sites of these cells was more or less similar for 2 hours and dropped only a little bit at 4 hours. Now if you compare PLEKHA7 or PDZD11 knockout cells, we see that there was there is little formation of the pores at the cell-cell contact sites in PLEKHA7. But then as soon as you remove toxin from the media and let them recover, they are not stable at all. So they go away from the cell-cell contact sites. But remember that they are still present on the other cell surfaces, but they are just not clustered. So the fourth question and the final question we asked that how all these proteins, ADAM10, PLEKHA7, PDZD11, and tetraspanins, they are interconnected to each other. So I just give you like a small piece of data from a lot of biochemistry we did. So this is a proximity ligation assay. So in simple terms, that if the two proteins are in proximity, you see a signal in the form of red dots. So this is the control, PLEKHA7 and PDZD11. They are in proximity at the junctions, so you see a nice signal at the junctions. In the absence of PDZD11, you don't see it, so it's a negative control. So we find that all these proteins, for example, PLEKHA7 and ADAM10, and also PLEKHA7 and tetraspanin 33, or ADAM10 or tetraspanin and tetraspanin 33, they are all in close proximity, as we can detect the signals in the epithelial cells at the junctions. But in the PDZD11 knockout cells, you don't see the signals anymore. So that is quite interesting that PDZD11 somehow promotes the interaction between these proteins. And that is exactly what we find in the co-IP experiments, which I don't show here, and the pull-down, which is here. So here, if you can just look in this like last three lanes, what we find that the C-terminal of tetraspanin 33 could bind to the N-terminal amino acids of PLEKHA7. But more interestingly, when you put the third protein in the lysate, you see the interaction is significantly increased. But it does not. This N-terminal region of PLEKHA7 does not interact with ADAM10. But when we make the bigger N-terminal, like with 500 amino acids, we see that it interacts very weakly with ADAM10. We also did other pull-down experiments showing that PDZD11 neither binds to tetraspanin 33 or ADAM10. We also show that afadin can bind very strongly to the C-terminal of ADAM10 and thus stabilizing the whole complex. So if I have to sum up everything what I have said in a slide, so this is the model we propose that at the cell-cell junctions of epithelial cells, PLEKHA7 recruits PDZD11. And the recruitment of PDZD11 somehow changed the conformation of PLEKHA7 so that now it can bind to very strongly to tetraspanin 33, C-terminal, and also binds to ADAM10, although weakly, to the region which overlaps with afadin. Afadin, this protein was also identified in the screen, and we show that afadin could bind very strongly with the C-terminal of ADAM10, thus stabilizing the whole complex. So this is the case what you see at the junctions, and we suspect that at the lateral cell-cell surfaces, this complex is not present. So the pores that are formed, they are not very stable, or they are able to endocytose, or they are able to remove quickly. And that is the reason that we see recovery in the knockout cells of PLEKHA7 or PDZD11. But the pores that are formed here at the cell junctions, they are very stable due to the presence maybe of cytoskeleton or the stable complex. The cells are not able to get rid of these pores, and this leads to cell death over the period of time. So with that, I would end my talk. I would like to acknowledge my boss, Sandra, for giving me opportunity to work in her lab, also the people who are involved in this project, the external collaborators, the screen was performed in the lab, for Eric, who works in Paris as well. He is a guy of tetraspanins, he discovered tetraspanins. And also the organizers for giving me opportunity to speak here. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you. We have time for one or two questions.
So to test your idea of this stability, if you take your cells with a toxin that are making the monolayer, and you break the junction maybe by putting EDTA, do you now get the loss of the toxicity, maybe by endocytosis of the pore?
So the thing is, when we want to look at epithelial cells, we have to administer the toxin basolaterally. So we have to put, because ADAM10, as you see, it's at the junctions, and distributed on the lateral surfaces, and there is a tight junctions on top, so the toxin cannot penetrate the tight junctions. So we have to administer this basolaterally.
That's okay, but you have your model system where you have a layer of cells, put the toxin, it's accumulating.
So yeah, that so that is so that is.
Break. If you now put EDTA to break, so you put the toxin, now you break.
So yeah, so what I don't show here is that junctions, the formation of the junctions is very important. And it has already been shown before that if the junctions are not formed properly, there is no effect of toxin. So for example, what we show is that this effect is also dependent on confluency of the cells. So if I put on, like, the cells are not confluent enough, there is very little effect of toxin, but when they are very well polarized and very confluent, they die in like 4 or 5 hours compared to 24 hours in the cells which are not confluent. And also if I treat the cells, for example, the HAP cells, which are not connected, we are like single cells, there is no effect of toxin whatsoever. So the junction formation is must for the toxin to act.
It's not to work, it's just give stability. The toxin is acting all the time because you're losing ATP.
Yeah, so
it's just you're removing this.
So I did not look at the ATP, but I don't see any morphological change. So yeah, the toxin is still working, but you don't see cell death. So this is my observation, that if it dies or not. So maybe if I look at ATP, for example, it would be like recovering, for example.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so last question.
Is it specific to epithelial cells, and whether e-cadherin is required for this?
This is very difficult to test if e-cadherin is required or not, because if you remove e-cadherin, for example, the whole complex is destabilized. So it would be very difficult. But in the screen, you know, if you look, if you remove e-cadherin, the effect is like they find in the scene, for example, n-cadherin. And this effect is much less than PLEKHA7. So I think e-cadherin would be involved, but indirectly. And it might work, in fact, by removing PLEKHA7 from the junctions. So this could be.
Is the reason it's specific for epithelial cells?
No, it's not really specific for epithelial cells. It just because HAP cells, they are not epithelial cells. They are myoblastic origin. As long as it has this complex in the cells, it's enough.
All right. Well, by measuring ATP, you're actually measuring the metabolic state of the cell.
Yeah.
So I don't quite understand how they recover regenerating ATP. If the cells are dying, they're dying. They cannot recover.
I think the cells to do with the threshold limits of apoptosis, because I only measure ATP, but at the same time, there is calcium efflux. Right. There are many things.
ATP is going down?
Because the cells are, first of all, not healthy, and they are like leaking from the pores.
Yeah, but if they are leaking, they cannot recover. They die.
They, in the case of wild-type cells, they die. But in the knockout, imagine a situation that the pores are now removed and there are no pores anymore.
Right.
The cells are not well, of course, but over the period of time, so that's why they don't recover 100%, but over the period of time, like if I wait for 2-3 days, they will be normal and dividing. So there has some effect of ATP, like toxin treatment, but it takes time and they recover. And you can see very well in this like mice model, they also do for pneumonia. So they treat the cells with bacteria, the bacteria dies of pneumonia in the wild type, but if you treat the knockout cells, the bacteria are happy, I mean, sorry, the mouse are happy. And they don't have pneumonia anymore. So.
Okay, so I think we should stop here. Thank you
so much.
Jimit.